สวัสดีค่ะ. Good morning, welcome to Kaulak, and welcome to the International Seminar on Demographic Differential Vulnerability to Natural Disasters in the Context of Climate Change Adaptation. I am Raya Muttarak, and I believe that I have exchanged email with all of you, so here I am, and it's great to meet you face to face. So many of you have flown from far away, from Africa, from North America, from Europe, and from other countries in Asia. So I hope you had a smooth trip and you don't suffer too much from the jet lag. But we have plenty of coffee, so just make sure you grab one. So I would like to thank first the generous funding that we received to organize this conference from the European Research Council and from Chula Global Network based in Bangkok. And I also would like to thank the three organizing institutions. So without the collaboration between the three organizations, we wouldn't have this conference. So we, I would like to thank the College of Population Studies, Chulalongkorn University based in Bangkok, the IUSSP, the International Union for the Scientific Study of Population, and the Wittgenstein Centre for Demography and Global Human Capital based in Vienna. In this conference, we have received 91 abstract submissions. So it was a lot of work for the scientific committee members to go through all the abstracts and the extended abstract to select these original 18 research papers that we would hear today, in these coming 3 days. So let me take this opportunity to introduce you the 7 scientific committee members who are behind all the scientific organization of this meeting. So first we have Susanna Adamo from the Center for International Earth Science Information Network from Columbia University, and Adrian Hayes from ANU, Australian National University, Lewen Jiang from National Center for Atmospheric Research based in Boulder, Colorado, Vipan Prachuopmok from College of Population Studies, and Tanyapon Jangrajang, also from College of Population Studies, Wolfgang Lutz from Wittgenstein Center, and Samir Casey from also from the Wittgenstein Center. So before I make the announcement of the change in the conference program and so on, I would like first to introduce the Dean of the College Population Studies, Worawet Suwanrada, to give his welcome speech. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. I think everyone has seen my face in your back already. Professor Adrian Hayes, Professor Wolfgang Lutz, scientific committees, distinguished participants, ladies and gentlemen. It is my great pleasure to take part in this opening ceremony of the International Seminar on Demographic Differential Vulnerability to National Disasters in the Context of Climate Change Adaptation. On behalf of the College of Population Studies, CPS, and Chulalongkorn University, I would like to warmly welcome all of you to Thailand and to Khaolak, Phang Nga Province. As the Dean of College of Population Studies, it is also my pleasure to attain the best opportunity for close collaborative with the IUSSP Scientific Panel on Climate Change and the Wittgenstein Center for Demography and Global Human Capital in organizing this international seminar. College of Population Studies, together with Chulalongkorn University, have recognized the importance of international collaboration, and CPS and Chulalongkorn University are serving as the gateway for the international activities, which are, for example, collaborative projects, academic exchange with international institutes, and academic services to international communities, In addition, we have always taken a role in implementing the interactive collaboration in international communities in various dimensions. This international seminar is one of the examples showing our strong commitment in such an important role. Finally, I would like to take this opportunity to express my special thanks to the IUSSP Scientific Panel on Climate Change and the Wittgenstein Center for initiating and organizing this excellent international seminar. And I would like to thank the scientific committee for reviewing and selecting the excellent papers from a large number of abstracts. And I also thank all presenters, papers contributors, and chairpersons in all sessions. And of course, I would like to thank all panelists from the Philippines and from Thailand to come to join the round table discussion tomorrow in the morning session, and whom I should not forget to deliver my special thanks is the two granting agencies, European Research Council and JULA Global Network. And of course, I would like to extend my sincere thanks to Dr. Raya Muttarak. She has contributed a lot in the connecting us together today. And I would like to thank College of Population Studies staff, Dr. Vipan Prachuopmo and Dr. Thanyapon Jankrajang and Kun Chaneti Milin Thangkun for supporting this seminar. But unfortunately, now Kun Chaneti has admitted at the hospital because she has broken her leg last week. She truly looking forward to joining this seminar, but unfortunately she couldn't come here. I also thanks our supporting staff and some PhD students sitting in front of the seminar room who supporting us very good for the organization. And I hope you will find this international seminar interesting and useful. I wish your success in this seminar and hope that you can furthermore strengthen your research network for future collaboration and not only academic exchanges or networking. Please find some time after the session of each day. Enjoy Phanga's excellent beach and resort as well. Thank you very much.
May I ask the chair of the IUSSP Scientific Panel on Climate Change, Adrian Hayes, to give us a welcome speech. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. I would like to add another welcome to those already elegantly expressed by Raya and Dean Worawet. This time on behalf of the scientific panel of the IUSSP looking at climate change. The panel was established in 2011, and our goals are to strengthen and expand the network of population researchers working on the causes and consequences of climate change. Secondly, to encourage the development of a richer and deeper understanding of the ways population dynamics and climate change interact. And finally, to ensure that this improved understanding is made available to a wide range of researchers and policymakers. We sponsored our first international seminar in November 2012, held in Canberra, Australia, with the title Population Dynamics and the Human Dimensions of Climate Change. An important outcome of that seminar was the identification of how future population research on climate change can position itself strategically in relation to the latest generation of climate scenarios, and especially the so-called shared socioeconomic pathways. This could, and hopefully will, bring an exciting new focus and energy to our research community and to the climate debate. For those of you who were not at the seminar, but who are interested in the outcomes, I recommend the current issue of Population and Environment, the March 2014 issue, just out, and it looks like this. This special issue has the title Population and Climate, Research Innovations and Bridges to Policy, and it consists entirely of papers which were first presented at our first international seminar. I'm sorry I don't have complimentary copies to give everyone, but hopefully you'll be able to access the journal through your library. Today we are starting the second international seminar, co-sponsored by the IUSSP panel. This time, as you know, the topic is Demographic Differential Vulnerability to Natural Disasters in the Context of Climate Change Adaptation. In a few minutes, Wolfgang Lutz will explain more about the theme of this seminar. I want to take the opportunity, however, to say something about IUSSP, and that is, if you're not already a member, then please seriously consider becoming one. The IUSSP is the main international professional association for population experts. It's been active since 1928. It keeps members informed of relevant developments around the world, and it supports involvement in international research networks like this one. Well, we're all looking forward to a stimulating and productive seminar. We've got a great lineup of papers representing a variety of theoretical and methodological approaches. We hope our discussions will deepen our common understanding of the field, and that as a research community, we will discover new lines of inquiry and new research priorities. We are hoping that our discussions will be able to, from our discussions, that we'll be better able to integrate our insights from different pieces of research, and in this way, introduce more cohesion and organization of knowledge in what is relatively a new and still emerging field of inquiry, this overlap between population and climate change. So on behalf of the panel, I want to thank you all for submitting papers and for coming to Kaolack to participate. I want to thank our colleagues at the Wittgenstein Centre and at the Chulalongkorn College of Population Studies for organizing the preparations of this event so well, and for choosing such a beautiful and also such a meaningful venue. So again, welcome everyone, enjoy Thailand and enjoy the seminar. Thank you.
Yes, thank you very much. Good morning, everybody. I am very happy to see so many of you here in Kaolack, some very known faces and other new faces, and I do hope this will become a very interactive and stimulating discussion. I apologize at the beginning for this very formal setting that was set up, and partly it's a little difficult, I take it, for people to see the screen. We are negotiating, maybe we can in the lunch break or tonight make it a little less informal. Well, the word the Wittgenstein Center was mentioned several times here. You find outside some information. It essentially is a collaboration between three groups who do demographic research in the Vienna area. The oldest is the population program at the International Institute for Applied Systems Analysis, IIASA. Then there is the Austrian Academy of Sciences as the Vienna Institute of Demography, and then more recently at the WU, the Vienna University of Economics and Business, there also is a demography group. And they are working together and got some joint funding under the Austrian Wittgenstein grant scheme. And so that is the reason for the Wittgenstein Center, which of course is named after the Austrian philosopher Ludwig Wittgenstein, who then worked in Cambridge. Now, when trying to see how to introduce this seminar, I was going back and reading the most recent reports of the IPCC, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. As you are aware of, they have recently completed the fifth assessment report. I shouldn't say they, because I myself served as a lead author, as did Leiwen Zhang, who is here. We both served in the working group three, which deals sort of with the mitigation of climate change. And the working group one deals with the natural science part. And the working group two deals with, impact, vulnerability, and adaptation. So they have a very nice chart here in one of their publications that I copied, which really helps to define the terminology that is being used. And increasingly, there is sort of consensus that that is the right terminology, because there often is a lot of confusion. What is risk? What is vulnerability? What is hazard? And so on. So I try to quickly explain this chart and the terms involved, and it would be great if we also could, when we talk about these issues, try to adhere to this terminology. So what you see here is on the left-hand side, you see the climate. The natural science is dealing with this. So there is some natural variability to the climate, and then there is the anthropogenic climate change. The change in climate that with very, very high certainty now is assessed as being caused by our human action. Now, these changes in the climate affect what we usually call the hazards. That is sort of the natural hazard. That happens even sort of without the people being involved. That's the new hurricanes that come. That is sea level rise. That is some changes to the natural environment. And I give you the more formal definitions of these terms on the next slide, but I just introduce it intuitively. But if there's just a hazard, if there's a big storm, without people or humans being exposed to it, well, there is no particular risk for human well-being there. So the hazard alone is not enough. There needs to be exposure, and this is this other circle here. So exposure means essentially a human being there where the hazard takes place. Like if the recent cyclone that we saw on the Philippines would have just passed over an uninhabited island, yes, there would have been some trees fall down and so on, but it wouldn't have affected the human well-being. So humans need to be exposed to the hazard. And several of the papers today that we hear today and tomorrow actually deal with this issue. Where are people living and how are they exposed to the hazard? But being exposed to a hazard is not necessarily a risk in itself. There also needs to be this third element, which is the vulnerability. If they are perfectly protected against something, let's say there's a heat wave in Las Vegas where everybody has air conditioning and so people are exposed to it, but the vulnerability is relatively low there. So, and that is actually where much of the social science also comes in. Who is vulnerable? And the scientific research community has said, mostly in the past, and the non-demographic community, if I may say so, dealing with vulnerability has seen this more as an aggregate phenomenon. They talk about social vulnerability of populations, of communities, very much a systems view. But what we have recently pointed at, and what is also the topic of this seminar, is that there is differential vulnerability even within communities, and even within individual households. Of course, different households may be different vulnerable, but even within households, there may be, according to the age, the very young and the very old may be more vulnerable than the middle-aged, and women in many cases are more vulnerable than men. So there are even within households these differentiations. So this is really this, both the exposure and the vulnerability are related to some socioeconomic processes, sort of the development pathways, the so-called SSPs that Adrian had already mentioned and we talk a little more about. And then there are adaptation and mitigation actions, and then governance and institutions, of course, play also a big role. And then sort of there's this link back from the human action then through the emissions to the anthropogenic climate change. So that's how the circle closes. Well, I put up here some of the formal definitions, but I don't think we have to spend the time now. So again, the hazard is the potential occurrence of a natural or human-induced physical event. And then the exposure is the presence of people, but also livelihoods, species, or ecosystems, so it's vulnerability in a broader sense. Then the vulnerability itself is the propensity or predisposition to be adversely affected. And they all are combined then in this notion of risk, is the potential for consequences where something of value, I mean human life is the most valuable, but other valuable things as well, is at stake, and where the outcome is uncertain, and then even recognizing the diversity of values, because particularly when it comes to material losses, some people value it more than others, or certain things are more valued. But the thing about the value of life, that tends to be something that is universally appreciated across all cultures. Okay, now this brings me to another conceptualization that has actually underlying the the project that was just is being finished now, that was mentioned, this European Research Council advanced grant on the topic forecasting society's adaptive capacity to climate change, where this seminar really is sort of the concluding meeting. And the way I've conceptualized this here, and some of you may have seen, I also had a keynote in the IPCC conference in Marrakesh some time ago on population-environment interactions. So again, we separate between the natural science part, the global climatic change as it happens up in the left corner, and zoom into somewhat more detail into the human population. So we, the humans, are indeed causing climate change through our consumption, mostly consumption of energy, but also land use change. And that causes the greenhouse gas emissions, which causes climate change. But again, not all humans do it equally, and there has been a lot of analysis on how changes in the structure and size of human populations impact the energy consumption. And some of the work that Brian O'Neill and Levin have first done at IIASA and now are doing at NCAR is really one of the leading attempts to try to disentangle the different factors of population size and household structure, urbanization, and so on, as they feed into different pathways of greenhouse gas emissions. But it is also us, it is also the humans that have to come up with solutions, so what we call the mitigation, the reduction of our emissions, and that is through innovation, through technological advances, that in the end, hopefully, will reduce greenhouse gas emissions without compromising our well-being and even economic growth. This is this notion of green growth, that we can have economic growth while at the same time reducing our emissions. So these all are the impacts of human populations on the climate. So what has received much less attention so far is the feedback, so to say, the effect of a given, already unavoidable climate change on our human well-being. And what you see here is that the global circulation models show you that there are likely ranges. There still is a lot of uncertainty, but the IPCC clearly defines some ranges on future temperature, humidity, extreme events like big storms and so on, and sea level rise in different parts of the world. And that somehow affects our health and mortality. It affects our livelihood, and also the movement of people, sort of environmentally induced migration is a big topic these days. But here again, it is not all the people, even living in a given territory, being affected in the same way by this. There is, as we said before, differential vulnerability. And this vulnerability differs by some of the human sort of aspects or demographic dimensions that we are considering. It differs by age, it differs by sex, gender, it differs by the level of education, it differs by the place of residence, household structures, and then of course some of the economic variables such as income and so on. So this is really the topic of the conference now. We used to have a study of the past 5 years where we zoomed into the education as a driver of adaptive capacity and vulnerability, and outside you find a just published hard copy of a special issue of the journal Ecology and Society that has many studies focusing on education as an important factor relative to income and other factors in terms of affecting our vulnerability to natural disasters. And there's enough copies that we carried over from Vienna for everybody, and I encourage you to look into this. Just a word, you may wonder, what does education have to do with demography? Education is often seen as sort of a social aspect that may or may not be relevant and something that is sort of assigned to people rather than really changing people. And therefore, we recently had done a lot of research to demonstrate very clearly and unambiguously that there's good reason to assume what we call functional causality from education to all kinds of desirable outcomes ranging from health to income and also in reducing vulnerability. So education is not just a proxy for socioeconomic status, as many of us social scientists tend to see it, but it really changes even the structure of our brain. We went deeply into neuroscience. There is Eric Kandel, who got the Nobel Prize in Medicine and Physiology in the year 2000 for his work. The book is called In Search of Memory, and other books like How Do We Store Knowledge in Our Brains? And he makes it very clearly that every learning experience, particularly if we repeat it, builds new synapses in our brains and makes us physiologically different from before the learning. He very clearly said, like in a meeting that I was with him, he said, now let's repeat this point again, and I repeat it again, education changes our brains. Now when you walk out through this door, you are physiologically a different person as when you walked in. Education does some real change for the rest of our life. And that's very important when we look at the effects of education. It just is not something assigned or self-sorting, but it that has a real change. And similar to age and to sex, it has both sort of physiological as well as some social connotations and forces. Okay, and we don't have to go into this into more depth, but it is an enhancement of cognitive skills, changes our risk behavior, it attains our personal planning horizon, and we also speeds up our learning curve so we can learn from past damage and gives us better access to information, changes health-related behavior, and so on. Now let's jump to what Adrian already mentioned. How does the climate change modeling community that is primarily concerned with the physical side, the biophysical modeling of weather and climate, how do they deal with the changing socioeconomic world around us? Well, the first generation of scenarios, the so-called stress scenarios, were led by a group at IIASA under the leadership of Nebojša Nakičenović. And they, on the socioeconomic side, were relatively simple, not to say simplistic, because they only had two variables. They looked at total population size and total GDP. And population essentially served as a denominator there, like you have per capita GDP, per capita energy consumption, and so on. Now, the most recent work that is also reflected already in the fifth assessment report to some extent is based on a new effort by the International Impact and Vulnerability Modeling Society, international community in that field, to be more detailed. And there is this SSP, the Shared Socioeconomic Pathways, were recently developed. And in what I call the human core of the SSPs, of course, there are many more economic and energy-related aspects to this. We have population scenarios for all countries in the world that are sort of three-dimensional in terms of age, sex, and the level of educational attainment. And in addition, we have some projections of urban rural place of residence. And then we'll also hear today, or tomorrow actually, more about then consistent GDP scenarios that are consistent with the human capital trends. So again, why was education included in this? Because it has been agreed that education is a single most important source of observable population heterogeneity, next to age and sex, and it is a measurable, a good indicator that is also stable and consistent, and it really tries to capture in as comprehensive as possible way the empowerment of people to do what they want to do and their social status. Well, it was already mentioned by Adrian that there is this special issue of population and environment that describes these scenarios and also summarizes what we know about the mitigation side as was presented at this Canberra workshop. Now just to repeat again the logic of these SSPs, the challenge there is really to at the same time capture two dimensions, capture the socioeconomic challenges for mitigation, it means our capacity to reduce greenhouse gas emissions essentially, and the socioeconomic challenges for adaptation. And these, of course, are the same forces. And along the diagonal, you see on the left-hand side very rapid development that is also viewed as a sustainable development. And on the upper right corner is a stalled development and a fragmented world that has high challenges on both sides. Just to illustrate quickly how what is sort of the demographic scenarios behind this, you see the pyramids by age, sex, and the color gives you the level of education, with red having no education, yellow be having primary education, light blue secondary, and dark blue tertiary education. This is the world today, essentially, on the left-hand side. It still looks like a pyramid. It's now a bit over 7 billion. And then we have the two most extreme, the SSP1, which is the rapid development, which in technological sense also is the sustainable development. There you combine low fertility, also increases in life expectancy, with very rapid further expansions of education. So this is a pyramid that is not unlike what the European pyramid, for instance, looks today. So this is a very developed society. And then on the contrast, on the in the same year, 2050, under SSP3, you would see a pyramid that still is much younger because fertility is higher under these conditions. And also in many countries, the education progress is stalled, and actually the attainment distribution worsening in some countries because high fertility is combined with no further progress in education. So you have, even in absolute terms, larger numbers of uneducated people in the young ages. Overall, to 2100, these are just the scenarios. This is the SSP2, which is sort of the middle of the road, or if you want, the most likely scenario. It is quite optimistic. You see, as the world population is likely under this scenario to peak, and of course the educational composition is improving, partly because much of the improvement is already embedded in today's education structure, where in most countries the young are better educated than the old. This is SSP1, the very rapid, almost unrealistically rapid scenario that most countries would follow the path of, let's say, South Korea or Singapore over the last decades. And this is the most pessimistic, continued very high population growth and little progress in education. And then we have this SSP4, is a divided world in a way. You see both the blue and the red area expanding, so we have larger inequality in societies. Okay, well, this is not directly the topic, but I just wanted to give it you as a background. What we think now is a great opportunity for the demographic community to come into this analysis of the consequences of climate change through our study and our experience in the study of differential vulnerability. So far, much of not many demographers have dealt with climate change. This is to start with, and much of the work that has been done so far has tried to explain how demographic forces contribute to the emissions of greenhouse gases, and how reducing population growth, for instance, may contribute to the mitigation of climate change. Now, with this seminar, one of the hopes is that we also help to open up a new field where we demographers can bring in one of the skills that if we very successfully applied to, for instance, the study of health risks. Whenever we study infant mortality or maternal mortality or any kind of other cause of mortality, we tend to look at risk factors. We look at differential risks by age, by sex, and by many other dimensions. So this is our daily bread, in a way, in other fields, and I think we could and should apply this also to the risk of vulnerability to natural disasters. So we can bring these skills and the associated methods to the benefit of the disaster vulnerability community. Traditionally, this community tends to focus primarily on the spatial dimension, where are people living, and not so much, but increasingly also what they call social vulnerability of systems, but less on the vulnerability of individuals, as we demographers tend to do. But we know that even, as I said initially, within the same communities, different households are vulnerable to different degrees, and even within households, the risks tend to be different by age, sex, and other demographic dimensions. Well, I want to conclude with a little explanation why we are here in Khao Lak today. And it happened to be almost 10 years ago. You all know about the tsunami on the 26th of December 2004 that hit the whole Andaman coast and large parts of Indonesia. And as Vipam Prajwapmop of Chula and myself, and together with people at the University of Singapore, were engaged in what was called the Asian Meta Center for Population and Sustainable Development Analysis, I had a scheduled visit to Phuket for a research project just about a month after the tsunami had hit. And then Vipan and myself, we had a minivan and were driving here to Khao Lak. And this is not far from here, just a few hundred meters away. The only house that was left there, it was a fishing village. For some reason, it was stronger than other constructions. And yeah, this is one of the hotels around here. It's not ours, you can but it's just next by. And yes, as you at that point, I didn't believe that any hotels would be constructed on this same place anymore. It seems to be the end of tourism here, but tourism is very resilient. And actually, it's part of the reason when tomorrow we'll have this roundtable of local people, also the head of the local tourist industry, to see why did they reconstruct the hotels, what is their perception of a risk. Of course, a tsunami is different. It's not climate-induced. But we thought it is sufficiently similar or isomorphic, as used to say, of the same nature as some of the disasters that may strike as a consequence of climate change. So since we have this real disaster where we could study all kinds of vulnerabilities and responses to it, we thought that it would be an appropriate location for having this conference. Thank you very much.
Let me quickly guide you through the arrangement of the conference. So for all the sessions, except for session 5, each paper would have 35 minutes. So roughly 20 minutes for presentation and 15 for question and answer. So I would like to ask the chair to organize the questions and answer at the end of each paper. So each paper would have roughly 10 to 15 minutes for the discussion. So there is a slight change in the program. If you look at the program for session 1, session 1 would be shared by my colleague from Vienna, Jesus Crespo Cuaresma. And then session 2, the second presentation in session 2 by Zhongwei Dosi Ajaero. He has a problem with his flight, so he would arrive this evening. So I have asked Danny Alpha from session 7 tomorrow to swap with Zhongwei Dosi, so we have a change in that. And we also have the fun part. So tonight we have the welcome dinner organized by the College of hosted by the College of Population Studies. So it's going to be right here in this hotel, but on the beach. So it's going to be the barbecue seafood party at 7 o'clock.
So hi everybody, my name is Jesus, and I'm going to be chairing, surprisingly enough, the first session. We have a very interesting first session on differential impacts of natural disasters, concentrating on mortality. And I will just play bad cop and tell you after 20 minutes that you are supposed to stop. We're going to start with Martin Flatø from the University of Oslo. The floor is yours. Whatever you prefer, you can sit down or you can stand and do a little bit like, you know, rock star.
Yeah. Okay, no, I can stand, yeah.
Great, that's good.
Yeah, and pointer probably. The red button. Yeah. Could you, Right. Good morning, everyone. I'm Martin Flatø, PhD. Oh, what's this?
For pointing, the other one is for passing slides.
Okay. So this is for pointing.
Yes.
And this is for passing. Okay. Very good. Thank you. So I'm a PhD student at the University of Oslo, a center for the study of equality, social organization, and performance. I'm going to present a collaborative work with Andreas Kotsadam on droughts and gender bias in infant mortality in Sub-Saharan Africa. So we ask whether girls are more exposed to the risk of infant mortality than boys during crisis in Sub-Saharan Africa, and whether such a difference is likely to be due to discrimination. Now, Sub-Saharan Africa is plagued by quite high levels of infant mortality, affecting about one in 10 children. And households also frequently face crises that are economic, political, or environmental in nature. And this, and partly due to this high level of infant mortality, there's been quite an interest in factors that determine health outcomes for infants in Sub-Saharan Africa, and how this differs by gender. So studies on infant mortality in Africa and differences in that by gender typically find a large female advantage in infant mortality, and there's generally a lack of discrimination in breastfeeding practices or health-seeking behavior. Yet a number of studies are showing that this might be more common during more extreme circumstances, such as illness to the family or loss of income. And a first study that used droughts as an exogenous source of sort of income shock to households. It's a study by Rose from India, and she found that after droughts there is an increase in infant mortality for girls, which is larger than the increase for boys. It's therefore interesting to see, do we find the same effect when looking at Africa? Droughts as an exogenous source of an income shock is one reason why it's interesting to study it. Another one is that droughts is a form of an extreme weather shock that is likely to become more prevalent in the future due to climate change. What do we expect about the relationship between droughts and gender differences in infant mortality? So there's a recent study by Friedman and Shady that showed that aggregate economic shocks tend to increase infant mortality more for girls than for boys in Sub-Saharan Africa, which is a very interesting result. Yet it suffers a problem of omitted variables, in that a number of factors may influence both infant mortality and GDP growth. The paper is therefore perhaps stronger related to studies on droughts and gender discrimination in Africa. These have given a bit of a mixed results. There's a study by Ed Miguel from a rural area in Tanzania showing that droughts create an increase in the killings of older women in that particular area, which was a very early paper on droughts and gender discrimination in Africa. There's a study by Neumeier and Plapper, and they find that famines and droughts at sort of country year level tend to decrease life expectancy more for women than for men. And there's a paper by Kudematsu, Persson, and Strömberg, and they study how droughts during the last two seasons before the birth of an infant affects infant mortality through maternal malnutrition. And they also do that by gender, and they do not find a difference by gender in their result. So what we're doing in this paper is that we use variation in rainfall relative to what is usually found in a particular area. And by using that, we document a gender difference favoring boys after droughts. We are also very interested in what sort of households and what sort of communities that prioritize male infant during crisis. And that's why we look at variation across a number of contexts. So we consider how this gender difference differs by the stated preference for sons and number of children. We look at how it differs by female work participation and also by levels of female education. And for these contextual factors, we study them both at the individual mother level and at the broader community level. So we have a number of hypotheses of how we believe that droughts affect infant mortality and gender differences within it. In economies based on rainfed agriculture, droughts affect real wages through affecting agricultural wages, food prices, the quality of food and local economies in general. Without access to smoothing mechanisms, this typically also affects in the household consumption. And this may affect maternal nutrition and infant nutrition. Yet infants are typically protected to a quite large extent during the period where they are being breastfed, unless the maternal malnutrition is very severe. It's therefore been argued that time usage is perhaps a more important determinant than material resources, a more important determinant of infant mortality. Time usage may actually be affected in both directions following droughts. So on the one hand, droughts decrease the opportunity cost of childcare. So we might think that they would work less in agriculture and have more time to spend on infant care. Yet mothers are also likely to seek employment outside agriculture. And the number of activities such as fetching water might take longer time following droughts. These income effects may also affect caring ability more broadly, and particularly we might worry that it reduces the propensity to take an infant to healthcare if an infant gets ill, and that this effect would vary by gender. So there are also some other mechanisms that are not about income that might create a link between droughts and infant mortality that differs by sex. More rain typically increases the prevalence of vector-borne and water-borne diseases, and this typically affects male mortality the most due to their weaker immune systems. And hence, male infants may have a larger benefit of droughts due to lower prevalence of these diseases. This is something that we're not able to control for directly. Something that we are able to study more directly is the selection into birth, which might be altered by droughts. As droughts may affect the preconception environment, miscarriages that might differ by sex. However, we do not find this effect when we study it directly. So the data we use 68 DHS surveys from 29 countries across Africa. These contain retrospective data of all women aged 15 to 49 years and all their children. And we combine this DHS data with weather data from the ERA interim project in the 1979 to 2011 period on a 0.75 times 0.75 degrees scale. And we then use this data to construct a drought indicator. So for our drought indicator, we've chosen to focus on rainfall which falls during the rainy season. And that's because we expect that rainfall during that period affects yields the most. And we then measure rainfall during the rainy season. Normalize that rainfall over the whole 1979 to 2011 period. We then define an extreme drought event as a season with less rain than two standard deviations below the mean, and severe less than 1.5 standard deviations. This is how it's distributed across Africa. The black and grey dots are areas where there are at least one burst following a drought, and it's quite dispersed across the continent. So this is our specification. We run a linear binary model of infant mortality, and we look at a drought indicator, which we allow to vary by gender, and that is at the grid level, which is where we have the rain data. We do a symmetric control for floods, and then we do a number of fixed effects. First, we have location fixed effects, which ensures that we are not comparing infants across Africa, but rather comparing children born on the same place. The control is then grid cell specific, interactive with gender, and we also interact at location control with the calendar month of birth, because there's quite some seasonality in infant mortality in the data. However, this is not necessary for the results. We then have a time control, which is at the year level, and we interact that with the country and gender. So these are our main results. We find that an extreme drought lead to an increase in female infant mortality, which is of 12 female infants per 1,000 births more than male infants. Which is a significant result. We then find a negative effect of the drought on infant mortality in general, which is not significant at this level. So the effect we find is quite substantial and quite comparable to the effect of Friedman and Shady in size. We then did a number of checks on these results that we may come back to. And we then studied the context through which this gender difference is found. So one of the contexts that we were interested in was female work participation. And Sen has this this theory that the reason why there are so many missing girls in India compared to Africa is about female work participation, which then increases the economic value of girls. Hence, that's a variation that we looked at, both at the community and the mother level. Also, we would expect that mothers and places where there's a strong preference for boys, that would be a context where we would see a lot of discrimination. And the preference for sons varies quite a lot across Sub-Saharan Africa. We have some of the countries with the highest degree of son preference in the world in Africa, and others where it's almost not present. And this, however, does not in the general situation lead to much of a surplus of boys, as can be found elsewhere. And the reason for that could be the very high fertility levels in Africa, which in a sense makes it less important, makes the gender of each of the children less important. And we would therefore also expect a differential effect by fertility preferences, that also have preferences for fewer children might discriminate more following a drought. Female education, as emphasized by Wolfgang Lutz, is another very interesting variation to look at, as female education typically reduces infant mortality rates and has also been found to particularly do so during crisis. Yet it has not been found to significantly influence sex ratios in infant mortality in Sub-Saharan Africa. And it might also be correlated with fertility norms, which would then have an opposite effect. So the results of these contextual variation, we find that that the effect is larger for non-working mothers and in communities where fewer women work. We also find that the gender bias is present in areas with high levels of son preference and areas where the fertility desires are low, but not in the other areas. And a bit surprisingly, we did not find any difference across mothers with different degrees of education. And we actually find a larger gender bias in areas with more educated women, which could be due to the correlation with fertility desires. So to sum up, we document the gender difference in how droughts affect infant mortality. And we substantiate that this might have might be due to discrimination, as we find significant gender gaps in households and communities, which we would expect to discriminate more against the female infants, such as the ones with a higher preference for sons and where women work. These results are very consistent with Sen's theory that female participation in work that's perceived to be gainful is important for missing girls and also in a crisis settings. Contextual results show that the social factors might be important and might. Very well be a reason behind the gender difference that we find in how droughts affect infant mortality. All right, thank you very much.
Thanks a lot. I'll open the floor for questions, comments.
Yes. preference, if there is any sex preference going on, it's very often in the standard of care of the children that the women give to the kids in terms of, for example, immunization, access to health services. And in that context, from your model specification and the different controls you are using, it's not so obvious to me how you are really taking into account all this information. Mm-hmm. And just also to clarify, in terms of the data that you are using from this DHS, you are using the full birth history of the last 25 years before the survey, or only the data of the last 5-10 years before the survey? The reason why it's important to clarify that is because the more you go back into the older retrospective information, the more the data quality, including the selective omission of births and deaths by sex, increase tremendously. So the standard practice is to use the last 10 years of data rather than the last 25 years if you want to have really more robust results. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay, thank you very much. Very interesting comments. Under 5 mortality, I think it would be very interesting to look at that as well. One difference with under 5 mortality is that you there also have differential treatment by sex, differential treatment by gender, which may have unintended health consequences, such as boys are allowed to run out more, then they use more energy and also have a higher nutritional need. But yeah, under 5 mortality would definitely also be an interesting thing to look at. This study limits itself to infant mortality, and partly a reason for that is that there are some very interesting studies that it relates to that also focus on infant mortality. But I agree, it would also be interesting to look at under 5 mortality. So in terms of data quality, we do a number of checks. So we allow one more month of infant mortality to account for heaping on 1 year. We've also tried limiting the sample to taking away the older women in the sample. And we also find it there. However, we do not limit ourselves to the last 5-10 years. Part of the reason for that is that you then also have a shorter time series, of course, which is a problem. But thank you for that idea. I very much appreciate it.
Hi there. Erich in the back, and then we'll come here.
Okay. No, it works. Sorry. So I have two questions regarding the education effect. Just very briefly, first of all, I was wondering if you looked at the correlation between the labor force participation or female participation in the workforce and education, because it might as well be that these two variables are quite highly correlated and that it is the highly educated women which are also the ones who are more likely to find work, and that somehow this covers a possible education effect. Secondly, I wanted to ask, in those papers that you cited on the education effect on infant mortality, if I remember right, the education had to be already quite high to find that effect. And so I was wondering what the average level of education in your sample is. How much education do the studied people actually have, and if you can then say something about where you start seeing an effect and how much education would be necessary. Yeah, so that's my question. Thanks.
Let's collect the other question and then we do the round for both of them.
Thank you. Mark Montgomery, Population Council. So I first want to congratulate you for a very stimulating piece of research. I think this combination of one huge research enterprise, a DHS program, with equally large research enterprises in the area of climate, drought, and flooding, I take it, in particular. That's a very creative and I hope combination that I hope others will consider as well. A challenge, as I'm sure you know, with using the demographic and health survey data, is to work out whether people, women in this case, were in a location exposed to a risk in the recent past, so a drought risk. And a problem, a fundamental problem with this source of information is that there is no information on migration that is location specific. We know whether a woman is a migrant, how long she has lived in her current location. We know we can characterize where that woman was previously, but we don't know where she was. So I'm interested in your thoughts on this fundamental challenge of what can be done with survey data that that lack the spatial specificity where migration is concerned. And of course, migration is an important potential response to drought as well as being a problem of data quality. Thank you.
Okay, I think we'll have to follow that afterwards.
I just want to say that, Charles Teller, we've studied this a lot in depth contextually in the Horn of Africa. And particularly when you're looking at severe and acute droughts, much of the excess mortality is actually not where people are normally residing. The excess mortality is often in camps and in places where the children are being treated. And the number one main cause of the excess mortality is often measles or some vaccinatable disease. The second thing that you have to take into account is that the service delivery systems have changed over this period. And as Mark says, that people are really moving around. So when we look at the unit of analysis, it's not a village or a town. It's often an agroecological zone that has shared the risk. But again, a lot of the excess mortality is from these communicable diseases, including cholera and measles.
I'm just wondering whether you have information on the order of birth or the number of siblings or the sex of the siblings, because for some studies they find that female mortality depends on that, whether she's the first birth or how many girls that have already been there in the family as well.
Thank you. So let's try and wrap it up quickly.
All right. So first, the education effects. So we tried different cutoffs, mostly without much significance in the effects, and correlation with the female labor participation. That's an interesting one. We do see that at least poorer women seem to work more. So it might very well that the correlation is the other way around. But that's true. That's something I should check. Then the challenge of migration. As you mentioned, the data isn't nearly as good as we would have liked. But what we can do is to limit the sample to women who have never migrated, and that we do. And that leaves us with about a third of the sample. There we find a larger point estimate, but it loses significance. As of using more agroecological zones, I think that sounds like a very interesting idea. And by service delivery systems, that would be very interesting to look at if we had good data on those systems. The birth order. So we do include controls for age of mothers and birth order and number of siblings in some of our specifications, and it doesn't seem to change the main result much.
Thank you. Thank you also for the speed answering the questions. So thank you very much for this fascinating paper, and I would like to invite Zhongwei Zhao from the Australian National University to present on who have been more vulnerable to extreme temperature observations made in Taiwan 1971 to 2007. Would you like to sit down? Yeah. Excellent. Yeah, of course.
This is an opportunity to report our research findings. In recent years, my colleague and myself has been running three interrelated mortality studies. And this is the study in Shanghai, in Hong Kong, and in Taiwan, which has been sponsored by the Wellcome Trust, Hong Kong government, and the Academy of Social Science in Australia, and other financial sources. Briefly, those studies have two major objectives. The first one is to examine long-term mortality change and their variations. And secondly, we want to study the relationship between mortality change and a wide range of variables that include the impact of environmental conditions. Over the last few years, there are many people involved in these studies. And this is the list of the project participants. I want to acknowledge their contribution to the project and also to this research. And what I'm going to discuss is one part of our several research projects. This presentation is largely focused on the relationship between temperature and mortality. Then the question is, why do we want to conduct this study? There are a lot of investigations and a lot of evidence suggest that temperature has been increasing in many parts of the world. And this is likely to continue in the near future. During this process, there has been increase in extreme weather events. And those changes have had or are expected to have a great impact on the future of the planet and also the future of mankind. Although we have a general consensus on those suggestions, there are still great uncertainties about the nature, about the severity, about the location and the impact of those changes. And this is the reason why we want to conduct this study. So what we want to achieve in this research? Briefly, we want to answer four questions related to the relationship between temperature and mortality. The first question is hot or cold temperature related to higher level of daily mortality? Second, is a more extreme temperature recorded in a particular period or a particular season of the year related to an increase or higher mortality? This is the second question. And the third question, has there any changes in the temperature mortality relationship in recent decade or in recent history? And finally, who are more vulnerable to the extreme weather conditions or extreme temperatures? Now, those are the four questions we want to study. Those questions will be examined using the data collected from 37 years in two research areas. The first area is northern Taiwan, and that includes the upper part, Taipei, Xinbei, Taoyuan, and Keelung. So this is the first area. The second area is the southern Taiwan. It includes Tainan City and Tainan County, Kaohsiung City and Kaohsiung County. So those are the two research areas. In the year 2012, the total population living in the two areas accounted for 60% of the total population in Taiwan. And in this table, we have the basic information for the weather conditions in the two areas, and also the information on mortality and the population. I'm sorry for the people sat behind. It may not be very easy to see. And here we have the mean average daily temperature, sorry, the maximum average daily temperature, the mean average daily temperature, and the average daily temperature in North Taiwan and South Taiwan. And then we have air pressures, humidity, and also we have information on the number of deaths occurred in each day. Because altogether we have data collected from 37 years, that is about 15,000 days. The maximum daily death count in northern Taiwan is 162. The small number of daily death count is 23. On average, there are 81 deaths per day in northern Taiwan and 59 deaths in southern Taiwan per day. And the total number of deaths used in this study is about 2 million. The population size in 2012 is 9 million in northern Taiwan and about 5 million in southern Taiwan. So those are the basic demographic and the and the weather condition information. Because of the time limit, I'm not going to discuss the technical details and some of the methodological issues, but I will report our major conclusions directly. The first conclusion is that hot or cold temperature is indeed related to the level of daily mortality. And this is the first conclusion. To reach this conclusion, first we have computed daily mortality ratio. That's the daily death count to the average daily death count of the year. So first we compute a daily mortality ratio, and then we compute a daily average temperature, because our temperature data is collected every hour, so we have to average it ourselves. And then based on the average daily temperature, we divided the 15,000 days in the 37 years into roughly about roughly 10 groups according to their daily temperature. And finally, we compute average daily mortality ratio for each of those groups. And here we have data for northern Taiwan in the upper panel, southern Taiwan in the lower panel. The first row is the range of average daily temperature. And the second row is the number of days included in each group. The third row gave you the range of daily mortality. The most important thing is the average daily mortality ratio for each group. And this is for northern Taiwan, and this is for southern Taiwan. if you can see the figure clearly, you will be able to reach the following conclusion. Both in northern Taiwan and southern Taiwan, you have a kind of a U-shape relationship between temperature and the mortality. That is to say, when the temperature was low, mortality ratio was relatively high. And when temperature increased, mortality ratio decreased. In northern Taiwan, when the temperature between 27.4 to 28.9, they reached the lowest level, the mortality. After that, when temperature increased, mortality also increased. In southern Taiwan, it is similar, but the temperature which relates to lowest mortality was lower. It's between 23.8 and 25.6. And here you get a very low mortality. After that, mortality will increase. So this is the first conclusion. I'm not going to discuss this one. The second conclusion, there is a typo in here. A more extreme temperature found in a certain period or certain season of the year is related to higher mortality. Okay, and this is our second conclusion. In conducting this research, or in trying to answer this question, we first identified from the 37 years period study period, we first identified a period with 1 to 20 days with the lowest or the highest temperature, and the year in which those period occurred. So that is first thing we did. Found the period with highest lowest temperature with 1 to 20 days from the 30 days, from the all 37 years. After that, we compute average daily mortality ratio, and then also compute daily mortality ratio for those period and also for the same period in other years, right? First we found the period with highest or lowest temperature, and then we compute daily mortality ratio for those period and also for the same period in other years. And after that, we compare the mortality ratio for the time you have a lowest and highest temperature with other year, the same period in other years. And here we have a table. On the top is the southern Taiwan. In the bottom is for northern Taiwan. And the first row in here, we have a period with 3 days, 7 days, 10 days, and 14 days. This is the period with the lowest temperature over the 37-year period. For example, the 3 days with the lowest temperature is between 25th February to 27th February in 1974. And here we have average or mean temperature recorded in those period. And then we compute a mortality ratio for this period, 1974. But we also compute average mortality ratio for the same period in other years. So that's the mean mortality ratio for other years. And when you look at this table, you'll find generally at the time you have a cold temperature or very cold temperature, regardless 3 days or 7 days, 10 days, 14 days, they tend to have much higher mortality ratio than the average mortality ratio recorded in the same period in different year, right? And sometimes the difference can be very large. But I want to point out, You do find exceptions. For example, when you have 3 days coldest period in northern Taiwan, this coldest period did not have a very high mortality ratio. There are exceptions because there are many other factors also affect mortality, not only temperature. And also in here, probably you already noticed that I only present the result for the cold spell, okay? And when you have very cold period. The information, we also computed the ratio for the hot period, but the patterns are less clear. All right, okay. So I will skip that one. If we don't have time, if you're interested, we can talk about that later on. The third conclusion, the temperature mortality relationship has been changing over time. Because if you look at a recent study, there are a lot of people, when they talk about the mortality, environmental condition, weather condition, they try to predict the impact into the future. When they made the prediction, they assume the mortality-temperature relationship do not change. But what we found is that there are significant change in temperature and the mortality relationship. And here we have two figures. On the top, we have a change in daily mortality ratio for the 1970s. There are 10 graphs, each for 1 year. So there are 10 graphs for 1970s. And then in the lower panel, we have same kind of mortality ratio by day for the period from 2001 to 2007. You can make a lot of observations, but I only want to point out one thing. If you look at the curve for early period, you have very noticeable summer mortality peaks, very noticeable. But in the later period, virtually, there are no major summer mortality peak. So there are considerable change in the relationship between mortality and temperature. Okay, I'm not going to present that one. It's difficult to see in whole. And the first conclusion, some population group have been more vulnerable to extreme temperature. To reach this conclusion, we have decomposed the mortality in hot, cold, and other time of the year by age group and by cause of death. And when I say cold period, it's referred to the beginning of the year to the middle of March and also the last 15 days in the year. The hot period between the 15th of June to say 15th of August, all other days they're regarding that as the other period. And in here, that's the result. In the first row, we have cold period, hot period, other time of the year, and the average. And here we have the distribution of deaths by age group, and the distribution of deaths by major cause of death. If you look at this figure, you can easily see that during the cold period, there are more deaths occurred in the age group 65 plus, and there are also relatively high mortality among those age zero. And among those dead in the cold period, you have higher proportion of death due to cardiovascular diseases. But when you look at the summer, you have a relatively high proportion died among those aged 1 to 34. They're not old people, they're not very young. They are people, young children and young adults. And also when you look at deaths by cause, you found they're not died due to cardiovascular diseases. They died mainly due to injury and poisoning. And when you look at that result, you may see the difference between hot period and cold period not very dramatic. And this is partly due to the fact in recent year, the summer mortality peak largely disappeared. So we computed the index of similarities for the period 1971 to 1980, and also 1981 to 2007. We also did that for hot period. And generally, if you have a greater index of index of vulnerabilities, that indicate people in this group are more vulnerable. There are more people died in this group. For example, when you look at in the 1970s, you found there have a greater indices of vulnerability in age group 0, in age group 65. And when you look at the index by cause of death, the greater index is among those that of CVD mortality. When you look at the hot period, the index for those aged 1 to 34 is far greater than any other groups. And also when you look at those died due to respiratory diseases and the injury and the poisonings, you tend to have much greater indices of similarities. Indices of vulnerabilities. And that tells you, and those group, or people in those group, they are more vulnerable to mortality in the hot period. If you compare the period between 1971 to 1980 with 1981 to 2007, clearly you found people in the early period that tend to be more vulnerable. Okay, they're more vulnerable. And I did conduct some further studies to look at the age structure of people died, particularly during due to injury and poisoning, and the people died due to respiratory diseases. And when you look at the year with the summer mortality peak in the 1970s, and clearly you found there are more people aged between 1 to 34 who died due to injury and poisoning. Okay, they account for almost for 60%. But when you look at the deaths caused by respiratory diseases, the patterns are less clear. And also when you compare the year in 1970s with major summer mortality peak, with the information or with the figure computed for the period 2003 and 2007, the major difference is that in the later period, increasing people died due to, because of injury and poisoning and the respiratory disease. They're old people. And the young people who died due to that, those factors considerably declined. So those are some of the major findings. I'm not going to talk about this and finally draw a number of conclusions. First, I want to point out that this is a preliminary study. But the study has made some very interesting findings, and those findings help us or enrich our knowledge about the temperature and the mortality relationship and the demographic differential vulnerabilities to natural disasters. Those findings also raise many important theoretical, methodological, and policy implications. But on the other hand, we also notice that the study has led to many new research questions, and many of those research questions, they are crucial to a better understanding of temperature-mortality relationship. And finally, I want to say thanks again. We welcome your comment and suggestions.
Thank you very much. Floor is open for questions, comments. Samir.
Hello. Did you consider the sex differential, like whether it differ by sex? And the second question is about why did in the recent period the variation in the hot period, these peaks in the hot periods disappear? Is it because people are getting refrigerators and, you know, the air conditions at the home that was minimizing or these peaks?
Thank you. We did look at the relationship between mortality and temperature, both by sex and also by residential area. There are no major difference. This is the reason we haven't presented the result here. As for the reason for the disappearance of major summer mortality peak, there are a number of reasons. First, over the last 40 years, there are major changes in cause of death, and that have a major impact on the seasonality of death. And if you look at this figure, on the left side, we have death by cause. This is the full mortality ratio in 1979. And on the right hand, we have figures for mortality by cause in 2007. At the bottom, there are the cancer mortality. Generally, cancer mortality does not have a very strong seasonality or the mortality peak, either in the winter or summer. And if you look at the increase in cancer mortality on the right hand, you immediately see that impact. And the other thing, or the other reason, is that there are improvement in standard of living that include the use of air conditioner and other factors. And also there are considerable impact of improvement of safety management. In the early period, you got very high summer mortality peak, and many deaths are caused by drowning. For example, in North Taiwan, in the early period, in the summer each day there are two deaths caused by drowning. And in recent year, it's only 0.3 deaths per day during the same period. The decrease of drowning deaths also play a major part on that. There are also impact of change in age structure, and but I'm not going to discuss that in detail here. Thank you.
Thanks for the very stimulating research. And as we discussed, that maybe you may want to consider other climate variables, weather, not only the temperature, but also things like typhoon, the such storms. As you correctly indicated, that drowning is one of the injury, is one of the major cause of death. And if you consider to include some data on typhoon, then you will see these kind of patterns. And the other thing I was thinking that when you look at the differences between north, northern and southern Taiwan, and they have a kind of a different type of U-shape, yes, at a different level of temperature. Say in northern Taiwan is higher, 28 degree, and southern Taiwan was like 25 degree. So that's I think that's a kind of an indicator of other socioeconomic variables, indicators as Samir point out. And northern Taiwan is more advanced to some extent than the southern Taiwan, particularly in the past. And that's why, you know, the conditions for other facilities like air conditioning could differ a lot between south and north. So maybe that's an indicator that point out that you want to consider to include other socioeconomic variables in the analysis. Thank you.
Thank you very much. For the two questions, the first question, when I presented the result, most of the result I presented or I discussed from simple data analysis. But we did run some sophisticated data analysis including some of the results, which you may see them. They are produced using GAM, generalized additive model. In running that model, we have increased some air quality variables. We also include some other weather variables. The impact of including those variables do not have they do not have major impact on our conclusions. We are going to conduct some further data analysis, trying to include more weather variables, and this is the this is the possible for our study. Because the weather condition data or the meteorological data collected from Taiwan, including more than 20 weather variables collected from more than 30 weather stations by every hour, so there is a possibility. But a major challenge to us is that we do not have a very good hypothesis. How do you want to group the weather variables? What is the best hypothesis for you to test? Because there are so many combinations, and so this is the major challenge. The second question regarding to the difference in the shape between mortality and the weather conditions or temperatures. Yes, that is a very intriguing question. There are other studies suggest that for a population living in different area, you tend to have a different relationship between mortality and the weather conditions. In addition to the analysis we conducted for northern Taiwan and southern Taiwan, we also conduct analysis for Shanghai and for Hong Kong. Those results are not present here. We have noticed that there are variations in the strength of the relationship between mortality and the temperature across three areas. At the moment, we try to conduct further analysis, try to identify why you have that different variation or different variations. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. There's a question there.
Good morning. Thank you for the paper. It's really very interesting. And your last response is just going to my question. You mentioned that you are using the station data for the weather stations, and you have 30 stations data. Can you comment about what is the distribution of these stations across the two areas, and where is your mortality data coming from, and also what is the spatial distribution of the points of the sources of data? Because you just mentioned, and I think this is very interesting too, that you have the study for two cities that are different from this study that are more regional level, and I wonder if this could be one of the issues. Thank you so much.
Thank you. As for the data, for Taiwan, we have a 4 million death record, which means theoretically every death occurred over the period from 1971 to 2007, we have the record. And all those records can be divided by urban and rural, can be divided by sub-regions. And the weather stations also spread of entire Taiwan. And so you are able to conduct similar analysis for every major region. There are no problem to do that. The only thing you need to consider is that when you divide the number of deaths into small group, into small regions, especially when you divide them by day, your sample size tend to become smaller, and this is another challenge. But theoretically, we could do the similar analysis by region, by urban rural, by cause of death, by age group. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. So I would like to thank you again for the very stimulating presentation. And as the last presentation of this session, we have Emilio Zhagheni from City University, New York, who's going to tell us something about the impact of climate change on the demography of meteorological disaster mortality. Do you want to stand?
First of all, I would like to thank the organizers for making this conference possible. It's really a great pleasure to be part of this very exciting meeting. Today, I'm going to talk about the differential impact of meteorological disasters on mortality. And what I mean by meteorological disasters is mainly floods and storms. We will be looking at the impact of these disasters from a comparative perspective, and in particular, we'll be using data on causes of death from death registration systems. Now, this work is a joint project together with Raya Muttarak and Erich Striessnig. They are both here at the conference. So I'm presenting on behalf of the three of us, but please feel free to talk to any one of us, and if you have any questions, suggestions, or comments during the next few days. So let's start with the big picture. I'm borrowing here a figure from one of Wolfgang's articles that is about the interrelationships between human populations and global climate change. So Wolfgang talked about it earlier. I don't have to talk about it in details. We could talk about this for hours. But the reason why I'm showing this is because I want to locate our work within this general framework. So in this chart, we are here. We are looking at the differential impact of climate change on mortality. The main variable of interest is deaths. And the dimensions of differential vulnerability are age, sex, and development. More specifically, we're interested in the impact of floods and storms on mortality. Climate change has and will have lots of types of impacts. That could be heat waves, droughts, that could be impacts on ecosystems, coastal erosion, and so on. And this is a figure from the latest IPCC report that shows some estimates of various types of impacts and the confidence that we have that they could be attributed to climate change. So there are lots of types of impact. Our paper is more specific and looks at the impact of floods and storms. So framework is very broad. We're interested in deaths by age, sex, and development. Here is an outline of the talk. First, I'll be giving a little bit of background and talk about the data that we use, cause of death data. Second, I will talk a little bit about age and sex patterns of disaster-related mortality that we observed in the data, and this is in the spirit of demographic model life tables. Then I'll talk about the relationship that we observe between disaster mortality, differential disaster mortality, and development. And finally, I'll discuss some of these results. Okay, let's start with some background. There is some evidence that the frequency and intensity of extreme weather events have been increasing, and there is evidence that some of these may be attributed to climate change. When we consider disasters, floods are one of the deadliest ones. So it's been estimated that almost half of all natural disaster fatalities are related to floods. In terms of causes of deaths, in the literature, it's been evaluated that drowning is the leading cause of death. The vast majority of deaths related to floods come from drowning. In the literature, people talk about something in the range of 50-60%. And the second leading cause of death related to floods is physical trauma, basically being hit by an object and so on. So there is quite a bit of literature about the demographic impact of floods, and some of the main points of the literature are that the deaths, the risk of death, depends on various types of characteristics of the flood, available infrastructure, spatial distribution of the population, and so on. And it has been found that there is a substantial differential by age, socioeconomic status, and so on. So for instance, people with lower level of education, people with lower income, and the elderly tend to be at higher risk of mortality. Now, most of the literature in this area has been relying on two general types of data. Most comprehensive data source about disaster mortality is the EMDAT, the International Disaster Database. This is very useful for comparative purposes. It's like the most comprehensive data set. On the other hand, there is very little demographic information. There's no age or sex of those who die or those who are affected by the natural disasters and so on. To complement this kind of data, there are lots of surveys. Some are existing surveys, some are ad hoc surveys that have been implemented after a disaster, after a specific disaster. These surveys provide very detailed data. They're very, very useful. They provide sometimes longitudinal data, but the main limitation is that typically they're constrained to a specific region for a specific interval of time, and so it's hard to make generalizations from generalization that go beyond the specific area in some circumstances. So for this paper, we decided to use some data that demographers use all the time, but that typically are not largely used in the disaster literature. And these are data about causes of death. These data come from national vital registration systems. The national authority collects the data, then reports it to the WHO, which compiles this data and put them into a general database, mortality database. And so we have some data on deaths by age, sex, and cause, starting from the 1970s. Now, there's been several revisions to the international classification of diseases and causes of death. For our purposes, the most relevant one is the latest revision, the ICD-10. And it is particularly relevant because with this revision, a few new categories have been added. For instance, for the coding X38 and X37, we have data about causes of death related to floods and cataclysmic storm. So this is very useful information. And we use this data that is available starting from 1994 for about 60 countries to get some sense of age and sex patterns of mortality. For the second part of the paper, we want to look into the relationship between mortality and development. And so we try to extend the series a little bit further back in the past. And so we also included data from the ICD 7, 8, and 9. For those type of data, we don't have the codes for flood and cataclysmic storm. And so in a way, we try to borrow information from related causes of death, such as drowning, submersion, and so on. And we put them all together. So let's start with some age and sex patterns of mortality for both death counts in general and for mortality rates related to floods. Here, what we did was that we took profiles of death counts by age and time for the various countries. We subtracted the mean from that variable, and that we estimated the first principal components of this matrix, so that we get three components that explain most of the variance in the data. And we have three profiles by age, B1, B2, and B3, that give us the components, that give us some patterns of mortality. So let me give you an example. So here are the first principal components for females, for mortality related, for deaths related to storms and floods. The first principal component indicates that most deaths occur to elderly women, relatively elderly women. The second component emphasizes deaths for young children and young adults. And the third component amplifies the first two. It's positive for young kids and the elderly, and negative for adults. So it adds to young children and the elderly and subtracts from people in the middle. So this is the pattern for females. For males, it's a little bit different. We still have a first component with deaths that occur at old ages. But the second and third component tend to emphasize more deaths that occur to adults. That's because there are more deaths that occur to male adults, and that's probably related to different types of risky behaviors that is related that men take. So these are just some patterns based on deaths. So far I just talked about general deaths profile. Now I want to talk a little bit about rates, mortality rates. And we identified three patterns, and I'm going to go through them by showing you some examples for different countries. Here we have the United States. Red is for women, blue is for men. The bubbles are the mortality rate related to storm and flood with the on the y-axis, and the size of the bubbles is related to the actual number of deaths within this country. So it's a relative measure for within country that we cannot compare across countries. And the blue, so the lines are interpolation of the data points based on a smoother. So one of the patterns that we observe for several countries is a pattern of monotonical increase in mortality rates with age, and a differential by sex, where male mortality tends to be larger than female mortality. And so we observe this for the United States and for a number of other countries, for instance, South Korea. Now, a second pattern is characterized by higher levels of mortality for young adults, and in particular for young males. And we found this for another number of countries. Paraguay is an example where mortality related to flood and storms tend to be concentrated at adult ages, and there is a significant difference between males and females. Nicaragua is another example of this sort of pattern. The third type of pattern that we found is a sort of bimodal pattern with deaths that occur mostly either at young ages, children, or later in life for the elderly. And for some of these countries, we also observed that female mortality for young kids tend to be slightly higher than male mortality. So Argentina is one example. Another interesting example is the Philippines, where we see that a number of deaths are concentrated here for young children. But in this case, when we look at rates, the rates are fairly flat, and that's related to the fact that the population structure of the Philippines is quite young. So on the denominator, we have lots of people. Okay, so just to give a quick summary of these patterns, we saw that male mortality is typically larger than female mortality across all of these patterns. The first pattern, the elderly are the most affected ones. The second pattern is a pattern where male adults are the most affected ones. And the third pattern is a pattern where we have a sort of bimodal distribution with peaks at the extremes. Now I want to go into the second goal of this paper, which is to look at how this differential mortality changes with development. And by development, we used a proxy, the Human Development Index, which is an index that takes into account life expectancy, levels of education, and income. Here is a figure that shows disaster mortality rate, flood and storm mortality rate, broken down by broad age categories, 0 to 14, 15 to 44, and 45 plus, and by sex. And it's plotted against the Human Development Index. So what we saw is that across all these groups, as the Human Development Index increases, mortality tends to be lower. Now, when the Human Development Index is fairly low, then we see that the pattern is fairly similar for men and women. However, at higher levels of development, the mortality rate for men tend to decrease at a faster rate than the one for women. And so we observe a sort of a convergence by sex. When we did that for different macro regions, we observe a similar pattern. The sort of convergence pattern is very clear for Europe and Asia. It's not as clear for Latin and Northern America, but it's still visible. So once we looked into this, then we decided to try and evaluate a statistical relationship between mortality rates and Human Development Index. We used the difference in difference type of model, where on the left-hand side we have differences in death rates for particular countries and age group, and on the right-hand side we have differences in the Human Development Index for the respective countries and groups. And then we added a number of dummy variables to account for differences for different categories, like males versus females, and different age groups, and so on. We tried different specifications, and we are still trying to figure out what the best specification is. But what we observe is that across all specifications that we tested, there is a very strong and significant negative relationship between mortality rate and Human Development Index, and a positive value for the dummy associated to females. So in other words, there is this negative relationship between mortality rates and Human Development Index. It's a negative slope, but the slope for females is slightly less steep. And it's in a way what we saw in the pictures. We tried also to include here a number of other categories. And well, just to summarize what we got, we didn't really get strong significant results. We observed that there is some weak evidence that mortality improvement has been mortality decline has been slightly faster for children and slightly slower for the elderly compared to the adult population. But we're still testing this. This is consistent with the sort of monotonical patterns that we observe at the beginning. So we're in the most developed countries, there are high levels of mortality for the elderly. And this is consistent with fast decline for adults and children, and slower decline in mortality for the elderly. But we need to run more robustness check about this. Also, I want to mention two important caveats about this type of analysis. And those are related to the representativeness of these countries. So we're using DEF registration data. So the least developed countries are not there. So it's so our results cannot be generalized to the least developed part of the world, because there's no data for these countries. There's virtually, well, there's very little data for Africa, only for a few countries like Egypt and South Africa and so on. And also, even for those countries for which we have modern death registration systems, there may be some problems with under-reporting of deaths or different labels that are attached to different types of deaths. So we are aware of this problem. We are trying to evaluate the robustness of these values by comparing our data set with, for instance, the EM data set, the EM dot. But I just wanted to warn you about this potential issue. So I would like to conclude with a couple of slides about discussion. So we looked into meteorological disaster, which affect populations in different ways, and we consider three main dimensions: age, sex, and development. Climate change will affect the intensity and the frequency of these meteorological events, and so it's important to be able to identify subgroups within the population that are at higher risk of death, and that's mainly for, well, or at least partially for preparedness efforts. More broadly, we show that there is a relationship between development and disaster mortality with societies that societies that are at a higher level of development, more able to cope with disasters. And by development, we mean societies with higher level of education, with higher income, and higher life expectancy, higher health. There are a number of standard adaptation measures that include building infrastructure, flood defenses, and so on. And those, in a way, come with development and are important. But we also want to emphasize that they're not the only force that is taking place. There are these measures of adaptation are not operating in a vacuum. There are lots of social factors that are related. And so, for instance, I was talking about risk-prone activities by different group. And so with this paper, we want to emphasize that different groups may respond differently also to levels of development. And so, for instance, we saw that mortality for males may decline at a different rate than the one for females, and so on. And so there is a lot of room to use this type of information to leverage the result, leverage the impact of standard measures of adaptation that are based on infrastructure and so on to improve the adaptive capacities of societies. So yeah, that's pretty much what I wanted to say, and thank you.
Emilio, first I want to congratulate you that have such an interesting research and results. And I have a lot of questions to the paper, but I restrain myself to only two. And
we can talk also later.
Yeah, of course. My first question is, when people talk about demographic differential mortality and to climate change, and the intent to say female population has a higher risk to the climate change, but your results, it's very clear that it's opposite. and almost for all the countries, and except the third group, Argentina and Philippines, right? And could you comment on that? And my second question is that when you have three principal type of death, three principal components of the death, and could you briefly say something about what are the main causes of for each principal components? Can you, have a way to make this identification? Thank you.
Yeah, this is a very good question. When we started to look into the data, we also expected to see higher deaths for females than for males. Part of the reason, I think, is related to the fact that we do not have a number of countries. So for instance, we do not have countries like Bangladesh. That's not part of the sample. And like those countries for which there is some evidence that female mortality is higher are not represented here in this WHO mortality database. And so there are some signs that, for instance, for the least developed countries, maybe mortality is slightly higher for females, but we cannot really say based on the data set that we have. Like for these type of countries that we have, and it's mainly Europe, North America, South America, and parts of Asia, but not like standard countries like Bangladesh, India, and so on. So we do not have a part of the world where we would expect to see this mortality. I assume that if we had that data, we would have a sort of an additional pattern of mortality that may be representative of a different region of the world. And then the second question is about the principal components. So we chose three principal components because they explain most of the variance. And there is a lot of variance in this data because for certain age groups, certain years, there are no deaths related to storms. So there are lots of zeros in the data set. So there's quite a bit of variance. And we picked the first three, trying to get some patterns. Like our interpretation is that the first one is about mortality of the elderly. And for females, the second one sort of adds to the children and to the elderly, the second and the third one. Whereas for males, we see a different type of pattern when we summarize the data, and the second and third component tend to emphasize deaths related to adults. But that's sort of an interpretation that we have. I don't know if there are better ways to come up with different types of interpretation. We can talk maybe later.
Thank you very much. Let me just follow up on Levin's point, because of course it was also surprising to me, and I first was thinking, where does this notion come from that women are more vulnerable? And I think it has to do with a few big catastrophes where we heard such evidence, like the tsunami 9 years ago in Aceh, where sort of the men tended to be in the marketplace in the country and the women with the children in the houses. And also there's evidence that often women sort of go back and try to rescue the children, and that makes them more vulnerable. But the statistical evidence indeed for the countries that you mentioned shows the opposite, which may have to do with the fact that men engage more in dangerous activities as part of their work. And this brings me back to the classification. Like if in the WHO data, let's say there's a storm and a boat with fishermen capsizes, is this considered as a sort of a disaster death in your data, or is it only if some really big thing happened on land as well? Because this is maybe the reason that it's just more profession-related injuries and accidents.
Yeah, so within the category X38 and X37 of floods, and there are lots of different types of more specific causes of death, and they could be like electrocuted after a flood or something like that. And so there are some of these, and all of these are reasonable causes of death that we would expect for a flood. Then whether people who actually reported the death reported as, so whether there are variations across countries, and in different countries people tend to report them with the sort of right label or not, that is not so clear, so we cannot really tell. But the different subcategories are there, and there are lots of them, and they're very detailed.
Yes, this is a bit more by way of an observation than a question for you, but we could ask, following Laban and Wolfgang's questions, why do we think the female disadvantage is present in disaster mortality? What prevents us from knowing whether that differential exists? I think part of the problem is that, as you mentioned, in the countries of the world where disasters are frequent, but which have not got to the point of having functioning registration systems, data on disaster consequences comes largely from humanitarian agencies. Those agencies have been tasked for 25 years with gathering sex-specific measures of impact, but of course they are overwhelmed in the face of disaster, and that kind of demographic data collection has not been part of the workload, I think, of humanitarian agencies. But I can't imagine that the situation is going to change unless some concerted efforts are made to focus on this as well as other socioeconomic differentials. I don't see that humanitarian agencies are going to be positioned anytime soon to take on the role of demographic accounting. That seems very unlikely.
Yes, my question was related to Wolfgang's question. Is there any way for you to distinguish in a better way occupational versus non-occupational mortality? Because since your sample is a very selective sample of OECD countries primarily, the occupational mortality, especially for men, but even in some of the Asian countries or in some of the Latin American countries, women, for example, have been involved in, for example, gathering seaweed, gathering all kind of things, let's say, products on the coast. So they are also exposed to diving, to accidental drowning. In the case of children in OECD countries, drowning is one of the primary cause of accidental death. In swimming, swimming pools, in rivers, and so on. So to distinguish what is from, let's say, disaster versus non-disaster causes would be helpful if the focus of your paper is really about natural disasters. Right now you have a mixed bag of things happening. I am not sure to what extent the classification of cause of death really allows you to do this refinement. And the other issue has to do also with the hill-defined causes. For many countries, especially the countries of Latin America that you were looking at, and some of the Asian countries, the unknown cause, the fraction of deaths that are basically, many of these causes are not medically certified. And many of these deaths are quite often reported in a specific cause only for a subset of them. So you have results, but you might want at least to distinguish among all your countries, and it's probably what's also going on with your HDI classification. The countries with the best vital registration gives you a piece of the story, and the countries with the more incomplete vital registration gives you another piece of the story. Some of it might be related really to data quality or reporting issues about cause of death. And in that context, to wrap up it's not even a question, it's more a comment. It's the World Health Survey. The WHO about a decade ago did a World Health Survey in over 100 countries. In that survey in 2003, 2004, they collected verbal autopsies and for sibling histories. These are not huge samples, but the only global data set. Murray and his colleagues were involved in that survey at the time, and they have used it marginally as part of the global burden of disease. But this information gives you some rough cause of death through verbal autopsies for least developed countries. It was the survey was conducted both in developed countries and in developing countries. So I'm not sure to what extent the classification that is available is refined enough for you to distinguish anything, but you might want to take a look at it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. My name is Stefan Kinberger, coming from the Department of Geoinformatics, University of Salzburg in Austria. Actually, I have three questions. I'm just asking them, but maybe you just respond to a few of them. But one first is, because I've seen these very different patterns in countries like in Paraguay and Argentina, why is that? Does it come from the data? Then the second was, I also could see a peak in the Human Development Index with the group around 0.7 or something. So why is there kind of this peak in the middle of this kind of medium HDI countries? And the third one would be more, there's a lot of vulnerability indices being created, and they are integrating different indicators, and also the age indicator is also one of the most prominent ones. So how could you see that your results can inform such kind of indices creation, like World Risk Index or others, to get much more evidence-based information on the vulnerability of different age groups? Thank you.
Okay. Oh, there's one more.
About the result that the impact of the Human Development Index on the disaster, I can't help thinking that you may have reverse causality problem, that Human Development Index can be determined by disaster, like historically. Maybe countries with more disasters do less well in economics and development index.
Yeah, so just start with this. We're not really claiming any type of causalities. We're just saying that there is a correlation, and it's a strong correlation between development and reduced mortality, and then there may be lots of mediating factors that are related to that. But it's true that, like, if you're interested in evaluating causality, you may want to consider the possibility of reverse causality. So I want to address first the comments of Patrick. So I think that's a, thank you very much for the comments about verbal autopsy. That's very interesting, and we'll look into that. It's also a very good comment about the different type of quality of data. And what we plan to do, what we want to do, is to evaluate in a rigorous way, for instance, how consistent these data from causes of death are with other sources, such as the EMDAT, the International Disaster Mortality. So if for certain countries like the US, they're very, very consistent. For other countries, they may not be. And at least to a certain extent, we can say something, these are the results for very reliable countries. These are results where there is a certain percentage of potential underreporting on one side or potential overreporting on the other side, and at least like give some sort of warning, like this is, we're very, very confident about this, we are sort of confident about that, we see these patterns but we don't really believe them because lots of deaths are underreported, for instance. That's what we think we can do. I don't know if we can really look into occupational, like if we can get much more out of the data from, if we can address the problems of underreporting more. I forgot one of the questions. So one of the questions was about the HFD, with the peak. So here there are lots of data. So this is a, We've moved this series using a linear smoother, and so there are lots of data points here, and it just happened to be that way. For countries that are like below 0.7 or below 0.6, so there are only a few countries, and there are some countries maybe like some countries that were more developing countries and so on. And so, yeah, I should go back and look at So I should attach some sort of confidence level about this. So if I attach some confidence level about this this series, there will be less confidence for this and much higher confidence for that. And so that's one of the reasons. And then the other issue that that you mentioned about using this type of data for various types of measurements of like various types of evaluation of indexes. I think that's a good idea. We didn't really start with that in mind. We started more with we started with the idea of classifying different patterns and like possibly if you have a new country, how can you like put it in one of the patterns and see what we may expect. And that's probably related to our background as demographers. That's what we do all the time. But that's a very good point, and we'll think more about that.
So thank you very much. I'd like to thank all the presenters. I'm sorry you'll have to do it in the coffee break. For an excellent session, and also all the questions and discussants. We'll take a coffee break of half an hour, and then we'll see each other again here.
We would try to rearrange the table a bit, so could you grab your belongings and we try to press up the table? I'm so sorry for the people who sit in the back, so we try our best to accommodate that. Thank you.